6 days left for Christmas shopping. 6 days left to fill the stock. 6 days left for Christmas shopping. Only got 6 days more.
Hi there. The Christmas shopping days are clicking off. Only 6 days left. So you better hurry, 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 hurry.
Shopgear.com.
The following is a presentation of the Gear Radio Network.
From Wherever We Decide Studios, broadcasted live on iTunes, Spreaker, and worldwide, this is the Turnbuckle Talk Radio Podcast with your host, the producer, Pat G. The G stands for gangsta. And now kick back and get ready for the eargasms.
Welcome to another edition of the TTRP, episode 84, as we are on our march to 100. Of course,
100.
myself, Pat G, along with Dan Fury, bringing you the TTRP, Turnbuckle Talk Radio Podcast, brought to you by Gear Network and all the great things that the Gear Network has to offer. How are you doing tonight, Dan?
Man, I'm coming off a really good weekend. You know, I got to hang out with Santa Claus this weekend. I got to wrap some gifts this weekend. I mean, PCO is now the 51-year-old Ring of Honor heavyweight champion of the world, and I got my email confirmation that my little bit of the bubbly has been shipped, so I can't even complain. What about you, Padgy?
I had a good weekend. It was very filled because I got to see a sneak preview scene of the upcoming Star Wars movie.
Oh,
thanks to Fortnite. Which
nice.
they had an epic little joint venture, so to speak, and they had the J.J. Abrams Avatar, and they showed the scene of Rey looking like she's about to use a Jedi mind trick on stormtroopers.
Oh, that's so cool. An actual intended one, not like the Force Awakens one where she makes Daniel Craig let her go.
Yeah, totally the wave of the hand. These are not the droids you're looking for.
Yes! Oh, I can't wait for this. It's just such an exciting friggin' film, but that's another conversation. We can go down that rabbit hole all day.
Oh, absolutely. I will say this on the side thing, Fortnite has lightsabers in it, and I hope they never get rid of them.
Didn't they also do the Marvel crossover with Thanos?
Yes.
They've done some crossovers before.
Yes. Unfortunately, no. So I think once the Star Wars mission things are done, like you have like 8 days to do them, I think that's when they are pulling the lightsabers out of the thing. But I will say this, having a lightsaber in Fortnite, totally awesome.
I can only imagine the plethora of video game nerds running around, you, baby Yoda, you.
Totally. And what's funny about it is after they did the scene, the Millennium Falcon raised up and everything, and they went back to the Battle Royale version, and everybody had the color lightsaber of the pad that they had jumped on, and literally it was a giant lightsaber battle.
Oh, what a great time to be alive.
Yeah, I know, totally. But in the great time to be alive, there is the time of pro wrestling. As Dan mentioned, the ROH, Ring of Honor, has a 51-year-old heavyweight champion. Claps. And of course, WWE and AEW leading to Wednesday night in 2 nights time, having massive shows. And we're going to get into that a little bit later, but we're going to start off with John Cena. And the fact that John Cena has not wrestled on a WWE pay-per-view event for all of 2019.
I mean, he made his WrestleMania appearance, obviously, going back to being the doctor of Thuganomics. But you're absolutely right. No official John Cena match on any pay-per-view in WWE in the year 2019. Like, even Undertaker performed on several shows this year. I mean, is this the end of the John Cena era? Is this where we can finally say, okay, you know, Big Match John isn't needed anymore? I guess that's kind of what a lot of people are leaning to by mentioning that John Cena had no, quote, official match in 2019.
Well, the funny thing, though, is a lot of people didn't really realize it wasn't really a story until John Cena tweeted out a kind of a teaser on his Instagram or Twitter or something like that of the keep calm and keep the streak type deal. And then that's when people realized, wait, John Cena's not actually wrestled a match all of 2019 on a WWE pay-per-view.
None. And I mean, the one funny part about it is that there was obviously an opportunity where they could have brought him in. I don't know if they're saving him for something big. I know rumor has it, and I mean, rumors in professional wrestling, is right now The Fiend is penciled in to either face Roman Reigns or John Cena at WrestleMania because they want to make The Fiend go against someone big. And since they're not going to do the pirate-themed Finn Balor versus the Fiend, why not have Big Match John come in since they already have a history together and that seems to be The Fiend's whole gimmick? But, I mean, it is strange that we went an entire calendar year, every pay-per-view opportunity they had to just bring him in for something, and nothing. Not one match. Zilch. Like, to me, it's kind of a weird feeling because, at least in my perspective, John Cena is always good for that one match, that one surprise match, or that one good feud in a calendar year. I mean, look what he did in recent years with AJ Styles.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, John Cena has kind of been the gatekeeper, so to speak, when a new guy comes in to get them aligned with the WWE style and or build someone up to be the next guy, a.k.a. like a Miz.
Yeah, and also, you know, Kevin Owens.
Yep.
You know, John Cena has a penchant for coming in, and even though he's worked on kind of a part-timer's schedule, quote-unquote, he always manages to put 100% into the stories that he's working on. And he, like, his feud with Roman Reigns, you know, that elevated Roman's stock. In my opinion, I know a lot of people dumped on him during that time, but I was like, okay, so you have the guy that everyone hates versus the guy everyone hates more just because they're on the poster. Okay, let's see where this goes. And it actually had a pretty good feel to it. I would like to have seen that as a Mania match, but, you know, John Cena's schedule being what it is. I mean, even his build-up with The Undertaker a few years ago where it was him doing promos on Monday night. That was it.
Yep.
He built an entire match on just him talking shit.
And then on top of that, it was just, okay, I didn't get this match, so you know what? I'm going to sit in the crowd.
Yep. And he was obviously seen in the triple threat tag, you know, triple threat intercontinental match. He was seen in the Asuka Charlotte match.
Yep.
And then you see him run off, and then there's that moment that he had with Elias, which was a real fun moment in my opinion. I thought it was kind of cool.
And then you get
the match with the Undertaker.
Yeah, and then you got the match with the Undertaker where it was kind of like Undertaker hit his hits and that was it. Like, that was the thing. Like, yes, the John Cena Undertaker match at WrestleMania was kind of a dream thing, but at the same time, neither of them needed it, nor neither of them, like, needed the victory over the other.
And the pay-per-view didn't need the match.
No.
You know, it was more like the sizzle to the steak. There was, the substance was already there in that pay-per-view.
Oh, yeah.
They just wanted to add a little bit more, you know, pizzazz to it, which they did. You know, they had, you have to remember that New Orleans WrestleMania was stacked a few years ago. And John Cena just added a little garnish to the side. It was like, oh, I'm here. Kind of like he did this year with coming back as the Doctor of Thugonomics. And I think you had the giant pop because obviously the New York, New Jersey crowd was just like, oh my God, the Doc is back.
Yeah, absolutely. And that was the thing. Like, I think that's why he came back as the Doctor of Thugonomics, because it was New York, New Jersey. He knew that he would get that a pop for that, because that's in New York, New Jersey. Yeah, that's the WWE town. Those fans are all WWE. They're gonna cheer for the thing that they want the most.
And he gave them a really awesome memory this year. You know, it wasn't a necessarily John Cena-less year. It was just match-wise there was no John Cena.
Yeah.
And he obviously has been doing a lot of films. He's, he is the voice of, I believe, a polar bear or a brown bear in the upcoming Dr. Dolittle movie.
I think it's a polar bear.
Yeah, he's an animal voiceover character.
Yeah.
He's also in the Suicide Squad, the James Gunn DC comics film, which comes out next year, I believe, which has got an all-star cast. You know, you got Idris Elba, Margot Robbie, you got Viola Davis in this one. So it's like, you know, John Cena is busy outside of the realm of pro wrestling. And, you know, it's the one differential, and I know that some people will probably, you know, chastise me for this and, you know, call me a heretic or whatever you want to say. But, you know, I can guarantee you that the one difference between him and The Rock is John Cena, during this hiatus, forging his film career for real, he's gonna come back. He's already made at least one Raw appearance this year, where he kind of did the rap battle against the Usos and had that zinger about, you know, haven't I seen you in a mugshot. You know, it's like he's gonna come back. He might not wrestle a main card match, who knows, but he's gonna be there. He's not going away. He's already said he's never gonna retire from WWE. He's always gonna be omnipresent. And, you know, is this a weird end to 17 years? Every year there's at least been a John Cena match. I mean, he also had one of the longest pay-per-view streaks in recent history, where it was like every single show had a John Cena match for, I think it was like 6 or 7 years, was some insane number.
Yeah, it was something like that. But you also got to remember, with John Cena and his schedule, John Cena will always interact with his fans and everything, because the man tweets out like inspirational messages and stuff like on a daily basis on Twitter.
Yeah. I mean, he's always there. And the one constant that you can say about John Cena is his work ethic has not changed. He's doing great work with veterans programs. He's donating money to and time and resources into first responders. He is going out of his way to continue to be a Make-A-Wish request. I mean, he's still being requested by Make-A-Wish, and he wasn't on WWE television. That goes to show you the star power that John Cena has. You know, and we're of course going to see some great things out of him from his film projects. I don't know what his character is going to be in the Suicide Squad, but when I saw John Cena's name, I'm like, you know, goddamn, DC has The Rock and John Cena now in their wheelhouse. Like,
yep.
That's two of wrestling's biggest stars. I mean, you know, no Stone Cold Steve Austin, but I mean, 2 out of 3 ain't bad, according to Meatloaf.
That's the truth.
And that, I mean, right now, as we speak, Stone Cold Steve Austin is probably going to get hired to be a villain in Suicide Squad 3. And if it happens, you heard it here first on TTRP. So pay us our freaking royalties. But yeah, I mean, I've always been a John Cena fan. It's kind of sad that his 17-year streak is over. But, you know, maybe he'll come back at the Rumble and give us a really good story leading into WrestleMania this year, because it's in Tampa, which is now his secondary home.
Yes.
With a lot of wrestlers' secondary homes. I mean, I don't think you're going to have many of them staying in the hotel if it's in Tampa. You know what I mean? They're going to just go home at night.
Yo, absolutely. And that's the thing. I feel like John Cena is going to give you at least... at least one more big time money match before he calls his career done.
So who do you think it should be? Like, now, like, we're in this weird conversation about John Cena. It's like, I don't want to talk about the twilight of John Cena's career, even though we're, you know, he's in his early 40s, and I mean early to mid 40s, and look at AJ Styles, he's still hitting his peaks. Who do you think the last big match for big match John should even be?
Truthfully,
dare I say there should be a last big match, but if you were to pick one, who would it be?
I'm torn, because the fan in me wants to say Balor.
Mm-hmm.
But the smart wrestling fan wants to see it be Miz.
You know, this is kind of, I'm just going to say Balor first off. And the reason why I think Balor is because, you know, the giant hulking guy versus the smaller guy, we could almost get a Hulk Hogan Randy Savage match out of it. And that's high praise for anyone who knows that storyline and just how amazing that was.
Yeah.
But for me, it would be Finn Balor, because you need to elevate a guy who is already close, who he hasn't had a feud with. And that's the thing. Like, The Miz and John Cena have, in a way, headlined two WrestleManias. And they've main evented one. They headlined another in the mixed tag a few years ago.
Yep.
To me, John would have to work with someone who needs that elevation. Don't put him in a match where it's like John Cena versus Seth Rollins. Okay, we've seen that.
Or
versus Randy Orton.
Or crazy idea, you coming off your putting someone with him that elevates him, Adam Cole.
Oh, Adam Cole, baby. You know, that any one of the NXT talents that is not, you know, of the thought process of, like, don't put him in there with a Tommaso Ciampa.
No.
Okay? Because John Cena will get eaten alive by the fans. Like, the fans love Ciampa.
Same thing with Gargano.
Yeah, don't put him in there with Johnny Gargano. For the love of God, let John go out like Eli Manning did the other night, you know, in MetLife Stadium.
Yeah.
I would put him against someone, you know, who needs that, a younger talent who's going to be around for a little bit, who would come off as a dream match. That's the other thing, is you need to pick someone he hasn't worked with that would come off as a dream match. And with the exception of maybe The Fiend, who I really would like to see work with The Undertaker more than John Cena, you could kind of put a bow on that storyline.
Yeah.
You could have John Cena against maybe a Braun Strowman. I mean, would that be a big enough match? I mean, is Braun at a point in his career where that would elevate him any more than need be? Or do you put him in there with Brock Lesnar one more time and see where that can go? There's certain avenues that you could go with, but the fan in me wants it to be Finn Balor.
Yeah.
At least to elevate Finn to be like, okay, you know, Finn's going to be around for at least another 5 years, 6 years. So yeah, Let's just put it out there.
And anybody that thinks that's a short time in wrestling, you're seriously wrong. Like, five, 6 years in professional wrestling, especially WWE, where it runs every week, 5, 6 years is a lifetime.
Yeah, I mean, and with the recent shakeup where now he's back in NXT, we've already had this conversation, I think a few weeks ago, where does this now mean that NXT matches are going to take place at WrestleMania? And also, the Royal Rumble is right around the corner. That's a time when wrestlers rub shoulders and cross-promotional matches occur. I mean, could a free agent John Cena, who lives in Tampa, travel to Orlando to give the rub to the NXT guy in Orlando, which is right up the road from where you're at? He doesn't need to be on the road. He doesn't need to travel. He doesn't need to be trying to make house shows. The house shows are literally right down the road. So, and he'd still be on USA in a prominent role, and you could show maybe a percentage or two increase in ratings against AEW for NXT if you were to put John Cena against an NXT guy. There's so many possibilities. I mean, I would go with your hypothesis of either Adam Cole, or my pick would be Balor.
Yeah, like Balor is the pick I have in the fan of me. But the smart wrestling fan would be like The Miz or someone that he's worked with. But you saying elevating talent, I instantly with Adam Cole, because Adam Cole is a talent where the crowd likes Adam Cole because he's got the catchy catchphrases and everything and the catchy intro. But Adam Cole's the type of person that he can make you hate him.
Yeah, I mean, he's got a grating personality. And that's something I love, is it's like you need to just go out there and be insufferable, but yet the crowd loves him, but they aren't afraid to boo him. You know, yes. What I mean? Like Kevin Owens in his heyday in NXT and coming off of NXT, people booed him, but they still loved him.
Yep.
You know, it's different with Adam Cole.
And
especially considering Adam Cole has all those other guys. Could you imagine John Cena working on NXT television against every single member of the Undisputed Era in a singles match?
In single matches, or in order for Cena to get a match with Cole, he's got to run the gauntlet.
Exactly.
John Cena John Cena versus Roderick Strong would be legit amazing.
And it would put Roderick over. And I mean, you know, O'Reilly and, of course,
Bobby Fish.
Got to root for the local guy.
yeah.
You know, and I think that NXT, if NXT is truly the third brand, they're going to have to be represented pretty well. And I think, if anything, this tester, this, you know, War Games tester that we had at Survivor Series weekend really does show that the product can be displayed on the night before, you know, a couple nights before the Friday night. Give them a chance to heal up. That way you can have those big match situations like they did at Survivor Series, where, you know, Keith Lee just went out there and, you know, obviously is the talk of the wrestling world for the stuff that he's done, and he's about to get a huge push.
Yep.
And I mean, it's because he had a phenomenal performance one night and then a second phenomenal performance the next night.
Absolutely. And from the reports I've seen from various sources wrestling-wise, is NXT's going to be involved in the Royal Rumble, and they are also going to get matches on the actual WrestleMania card.
Which they deserve. And I mean, if I were a person who threw money at a television screen and said, here, take it, you put Ciampa on WrestleMania. You put Gargano on WrestleMania if he's ready. You put, obviously, Finn Balor has already been and two in championship matches at WrestleMania. So we'll continue that whole aspect. I see that brand being lifted anyway. It would just be cool to see John Cena give it the big match rub.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Speaking of NXT, of course, we're going to get into the lovely debate of NXT versus AEW, because they've been kind of neck and neck in the ratings, and also Wednesday night the big guns are coming out, but we're going to get back into that after the break, right here on the TTRP. Ladies and gentlemen, it is Pat G from the Turnbuckle Talk Radio podcast. And no, we're not talking pro wrestling today, but we are talking sports hoodies, NFL, NBA, MLB, NHL, soccer, and much more. And this is brought to you by houseofhoodies.com, a new sponsor here at the TTRP. You can visit thehouseofhoodies.com and pick up your favorite team's merchandise. They have current players, former players, or you can customize your own hoodie, whether it be the NBA, NHL, MLB, and the NFL. After you're done shopping, use the promo code TTRPodcast and you will get 15% off your order. That's TTRPodcast for 15% off at thehouseofhoodies.com. And we're back here, TTRP, Pat G, and Dan Fury, and we were talking the rise of NXT, of course, and being known in a more bigger light with the main superstars of the WWE, of course. But NXT's been holding their own, because last week, the first time ever, AEW and NXT tied with 778,000 viewers, even though AEW won in the quote-unquote demographics. But at the end of the day, they tied.
Yeah, I mean, This Wednesday night war, I dare not use those terms, but let's just go with it. This Wednesday night war, it is not a blowout like some would have assumed. I mean, there have been weeks where AEW has been a little bit ahead, you know, a couple thousand ahead. And there have been weeks where, you know, obviously after Survivor Series, NXT had a bump. To me, this is showing that wrestling fans might be jumping back and forth, which is a possibility. We've talked about that over and over again.
I know I do.
Yeah, I mean, for me, my entire take is, it's like, if you, the beauty of social media, if you're content with watching one show for one night, you're going to see it on Instagram, you're going to see the highlights on Facebook, you know, it's like they happen in real time.
Yeah.
You know, with like maybe a 10-minute delay. So when Moxley comes out and friggin', you know, gives the paradigm shift to El Champion, you know, it's going to be seen anyway. The one cool part about it is wrestling fans aren't swayed one way or the other. And I've got a theory on this. And my theory is, back in, you know, 95 until 2001, wrestling fans, unless you put two televisions in your room, you really did have to choose.
Yeah.
And the choice was being seen on the Nelson ratings, and, you know, predicated on the quarter hours, and, you know, all the jive and the jargon of the television world.
And at one point, like we all know nowadays, WCW won 83 weeks in a row, as far as the ratings were concerned.
I mean, heavily. Like, this wasn't even like, they won a quarter hour. It's like, nah, they murdered you from the beginning of the show to the end of the show. They beat you down, they took your lunch money, and then as they were walking away, they just kicked a little dirt at you, and we're like, thanks, we're going to take this star while we're at it, and walked away.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that's an accurate portrayal of the Monday Night War. The difference is that, you know, the technology has changed. People have different ways of being able to view the same kind of product. And, you know, to me, and you and I, you know, you work, I sleep, you know, we have different schedules and whatnot, but, I mean, you can TiVo shit. Like, you can, you know, DVR both shows simultaneously. So if you have to go to bed, you can catch up on the show the next day. Or if you're, like, having to deal with work or whatever, and you're not able to catch up on it immediately, you can save it for Saturday. If there's really something that you want to see, you know, on either NXT or, like, to, you know, this week's show is going to be Adam Cole versus Finn Balor for the title. I mean, that's a phenomenal match. I want to watch that in real time. that's going to be great. But if I have to beat a bet, ain't no way I'm going to do it. DVR. I think the technology has changed the way that even the ratings are being seen, because it's not being seen necessarily in real time. Although if they were to be able to take the DVRs, like how many people are DVRing this show so that we can see it, and let's push that into the ratings information.
Yeah, absolutely.
Sure. You know, the numbers might speak differently.
Yeah. And this thing is in this day and age, you got to remember, well, you could easily DVR AEW. WWE has its own network. The NXT that's live on Wednesday night on USA is legitimately available to watch like the next day on Thursday morning.
Yeah, I mean, that's the beauty of it, is that, oh, I didn't see it. Well, I can watch it, you know, on the treadmill at work, or, you know, at work, working out at the gym or whatever. Like, you know, you can, if you really are desperate to watch that content, you totally can. And it's available. You can watch it. To me, the way that it goes is this one of those ever-changing things that we talk about when it comes to communications and technology, where maybe it's not giving an accurate snapshot?
Yeah.
No, I think it's as accurate as it's going to get, because I don't think there's one product or the other that fans prefer. I think fans are smart. They know that they can DVR one and watch one live. You know, we used to do it back in the day. It was called a VCR and another television in your house if your mom was cool enough to let you do that.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that's making us sound old as dirt, but let's go with it. And I mean, you know, you have different methods to be able to enjoy your content. I think fans are digging both. I think fans are more accepting of, like, I'll watch both because I'm enjoying some things on one and want some things on another. Much like the Monday Night War was back in the day. Like, well, if you didn't want to see, you know, if you didn't want to see the luchadors for whatever reason, you could turn it on over here and the Acolytes were murdering someone. Or if you didn't want to watch, you know, PMS, you know, rub chocolate syrup on a dude, you could go over here and you could see the NWO.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, there was give and take with the content, what you wanted to watch.
Yeah, absolutely. And the thing is this Wednesday, which is in 2 days, essentially, AEW and NXT both have their shows on, as I'm pretty sure, I already know NXT is not running the next 2 weeks on Wednesday because of the holidays.
Yep.
So I believe it's the same for AEW as well. So both shows are going all out, because AEW is going to have Le Champion Chris Jericho facing Jungle Boy. And of course, the Young Bucks are facing South Central for the tag team championships. And then on NXT, you have Rhea Ripley facing Shayna Baszler for the women's title, and you have Finn Balor versus Adam Cole. And then USA today just upped the stakes even more, because they announced that NXT will be broadcasted commercial free. With Adam Cole and Finn Balor for the NXT Heavyweight Championship opening the show.
Okay. So I would like to just let everyone know that I will not be talking to any human beings at 8 o'clock on Wednesday night. I will be watching that match. You know, you have to give it to the marketing genius that is WWE for doing that, knowing that they're not going to be giving any content on what the following Wednesday for Christmas, which is cool for them to not be doing Christmas NXT, so the families can all be together.
Yeah, same thing. Same thing with New Year's Day as well.
Yeah, and the fact that Chris Jericho has put it out there into the universe that the reason Jungle Boy is getting a title shot is because he specifically wants it, because he's the type of talent that Chris Jericho would like to work with. So, I mean, you've got new talent going. This was the discussion point that Chris Jericho has made about the Monday Night War as far as the WCW side,
yep,
that he didn't necessarily like, is, you know, you kept the old guys with these guys having the same matches. It's like Sting versus Rey Mysterio. Why wasn't that booked? Chris Jericho versus Macho Man Randy Savage. Why was that not booked? You know, Hulk Hogan versus Chris Benoit. Why wasn't that booked? And you sit there and you think about it and you're like, holy shit, those would have been great matches. Well, Chris Jericho versus Jungle Boy is a happening match.
Yep.
You know what I mean? I mean, and do I for 1 second think that Jungle Boy can win the AEW Heavyweight Championship? Sure. Because it's professional wrestling and anything can happen.
Absolutely. And this is the thing, and even John Moxley has come out and he's like, yo, I'm just here. I'm just doing what's best for professional wrestling, how I see it. And that's the thing with Chris Jericho may be the guy that everybody hates in AEW. And a lot of people are going, oh, why'd Chris Jericho leave WWE and all this? I'm like, this is the thing. Chris Jericho has been wrestling for 3 decades, ladies and gentlemen, if not longer. Okay. He's basically reinvented himself 4 or 5 different times over because of something. And then on top of that, now has the opportunity in AEW to be the top guy, but work with talent that's younger that he can establish. Because yes, Chris Jericho is going to work with Jungle Boy on Wednesday. You have Adam Cole versus Finn Balor, and 2 great matches. But who's not going to say in 6 months, Sammy Guevara gets tired of running with the Inner Circle and decides that he wants a title shot and turns on Jericho? Who's not going to want to see Jericho versus Guevara?
I can tell you, I would love to see that, and that could be an all-out pay-per-view match if they built it right. You know, I mean, this is the short-term attention span that, you know, we wrestling fans acknowledge that we have, but we don't really go out of our way to change. You know what I mean? We acknowledge we have short-term memory, and we acknowledge that, you know, we're kind of forgetful at times, but at the same token, it's like, build these stories and just build it, because you know the group is going to implode on itself.
Oh, absolutely.
Build these stories and make it matter. Don't just do a one-off and have it be one and done, because then you could have Chris Jericho versus Luchasaurus. Oh, there you go. El Sexy Gods versus Jurassic Express. There you go. I just booked you a main event match right there. You're welcome. I'll accept my royalties now.
Yeah. Hey, and on top of that, as we bring in we're talking NXT, not kind of straying away from NXT a little bit, the recent re-signing of John Morrison to WWE, and if anybody saw him on the Bump program, he talked about, and he gave a shout out to Ricochet. If I'm saying this, if John Morrison and Ricochet can have a Lucha Underground season 1 type match of Johnny Mundo versus Prince Puma, sign me the fuck up. Because
it'll happen.
Oh yeah, I know it'll happen. But if that exact match can happen with a little bit, with some changes and everything due to WWE style, holy mother of God.
I wouldn't even say WWE style. I'm going to use my 1F-bomb for the show. Here you go. Fuck it. Put that on Mania. Put that exact match on WrestleMania, and you will get the reaction that was supposed to happen when you had AJ Styles versus Shinsuke Nakamura. I mean, we got handed essentially a Wrestle Kingdom main event at the WWE's biggest event of the year, and because of the crowd, it kind of went off, and I don't want to be a jerk by saying this, both athletes were phenomenal. It went off like a fart in church. Like, no one knew how to react to it. It was a Japanese-style match that they almost identically had overseas. It just was put in the confines of the WWE. It was altered a little bit, and they had that crap finish. No. Put Ricochet versus John Morrison at WrestleMania, give them 15 minutes, and say, okay, guys, go.
Yeah.
Don't overproduce it. Don't try and put some flim-flam in it. Don't try and just say, okay, you're back, he's here, go.
Oh, absolutely.
Let's see what they can do, because that will be the same caliber match that Rey Mysterio and Morrison had in September of 2009 on SmackDown, which was the first match I watched live when I came home from my overseas tour number two. And I sat at a bar and was just in amazement at those two guys going at it. Now, you imagine Ricochet versus John Morrison, who's been out traveling the world, learning new skills and new tools, and he looks freaking phenomenal. Bring that and put that in Mania and just say, go have fun, or forget it. Put it on TakeOver. Do whatever you got to do.
Yeah, absolutely. And this is the thing is, this Wednesday night, it's going to be fun, because obviously both shows are going all bore, because the next week, 2 weeks, they're not going to have any content. And then, of course, USA is upping the ante, going, hey, we're going to broadcast this with no commercials, and going, let's see what you got, TNT. That's how I look at it.
I love the fact that there's this renewed sense of importance to the product. It's like commercial free, boom, go. Just like Clash of the Champions used to be.
Yep.
Remember that? Clash of the Champions was presented commercial free for
on TBS
years. On TBS. So you've got some people working at NXT who aren't afraid to pull that trigger. I mean, occasionally TNT would give you like, oh, this match is going to be done commercial free until it's over. Well, I mean, there's 5 minutes left in the show. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
Don't pull the wool over our eyes. The NWO is going to run out in like 5 seconds. But on TBS, the Clash of the Champions were presented commercial free. And you're doing this as like a gift to the fans. Well, yeah. Thank you. Merry Christmas. That is a great gift to hear.
Yeah, which means with Balor and Adam Cole opening the show, I can guarantee you that Baszler and Ripley are going to end the show. And what kind of a ending that's going to be, because the reports have already said that WWE's going to pull the trigger on Baszler coming up to the main roster, air quotations. That's going to be a shot. That's going to be a shot if Ripley ends up winning the NXT Women's Championship.
Yeah, and I mean, yeah, first off, I really like, you know, Survivor Series weekend was a shot in the arm for a lot of wrestlers.
Oh, it absolutely was.
A big shot in the arm. And she came off like, first off, they opened up War Games with the female War Games match, and her and Baszler just destroyed in that last exchange with the handcuffs and that. And then you went into the next night where her and really one of the faces of the women's revolution or evolution, whatever you want to call it, you know, Sasha Banks, they were the last two. And she dominated in that. It's like you're looking at it. You're like, are we going to see the woman that's going to dethrone, you know, the man?
That's what a lot of people were talking about, but it seems like they want, from the various reports, that they're building Shayna Baszler for that role.
Yeah, but at the same token, last year they were also building for Ronda Rousey versus Charlotte Flair at WrestleMania.
Yeah, that's true. Well, the thing is the rumor mill, so to speak, is they want... They're trying to talk Ronda into coming back, but Ronda has pretty much indicated that she wants to start a family and she's in no rush to return. So they're going with this next best option of Shayna Baszler.
And it would make sense to have her go against, you know, her, the person who, you know, got rid of Ronda Rousey, you know, one of the other horsewomen. It would be cool to see that, you know, I'm just sold on Ripley.
Oh yeah, I'm totally sold on Ripley as well. Like her work in NXT UK with Toni Storm was amazing. Now she's working with the talent of regular NXT and just doing phenomenal. But I think that if Ripley gets the title Wednesday night, her initial first challenger is going to be Dakota Kai.
Yeah, who's lit on fire.
Yeah.
And she's another reason that I'm glad they're going, uninterrupted, because, she came back and obviously Survivor Series weekend once again, War Games once again, changed a lot of aspects and a lot of characters, and Dakota did a complete reinvention of herself. And it's like, hey, let's see what steam you've got, because maybe you're going to be the person that next year has the championship around your waist, and it's going to be a monumental moment.
Yep.
It could happen SummerSlam weekend.
Yo, absolutely. And this is the thing, is with NXT and AEW, both are having stacked cards Wednesday night, of course. It's going to be interesting to see what they do, because also AEW's essentially building towards the next pay-per-view, which is going to be All Out, I believe.
Yes. As far as I can remember, yes, it is.
Yeah. And AEW also had a milestone. They announced it today on Twitter, I believe. They have sold over 100,000 tickets for their shows.
Yeah, in 2019. And you have to remember, they didn't have very many shows, people. I mean, that is a monumental success on the part of them. They've got some big stuff coming up this year. And I mean, there's people when All In happened, it's a one-time show and New Japan is helping to run it and Ring of Honor is helping to run it and it doesn't matter. Okay. Well, then they announced, we're doing All Elite Wrestling. Yeah, well, let us know when you have your next pay-per-view. Okay, well, here's our next pay-per-view. Yeah, well, let us know when you get television. We're on TNT. Yeah, well, let us know when you guys have a champion. Well, here's our champion. Well, let us know when you have an actual date for your show. Here's our date. Here's our ratings. Here you go. We're winning. Silence. Because you really can't argue with their year that they had starting at the beginning of the year when they announced All Elite Wrestling. Over 100,000 tickets sold at their shows is monumental. Imagine what they're going to be able to do next year. I see this snowballing in 2020 and being even bigger, because you have to remember, Nitro debuted in September of 2005 and they took hold in the ratings by July of 1996.
Yeah.
Wasn't even a full year before they were making strides in the ratings. You never know at this point what could happen in the world of wrestling that would give them a leap ahead of NXT.
Oh, absolutely. And that's the thing. And to speak on Cody Rhodes has said in interviews, like, they're not doing house shows. They're not doing live events like WWE or NXT or whatever. Like, AEW is All Elite, is AEW Dynamite. Like, Dynamite's their program. Dynamite is what they're using to build storylines, build characters up to like their pay-per-view events. There's no in between that. Because they're allowing the people on their roster to go out on a Friday and a Saturday to work an independent show to make a living or whatever, to make more of a living for themselves.
And they're also, I mean, this got brought up on a recent CM Punk appearance on Fox Sports 1, where he was being interviewed about his new position in in Fox and with the backstage show. And this is all going to tie in, trust me. They got to talking about the 52 week grind and how, like, you get home off of your break and you'd just be shell-shocked. You'd just be laying in bed and you're like, I don't want to get up. I don't want to get up and catch my flight. Like, I want to lay here. Like, I'm burnt out. With AEW doing television on Wednesdays, a pay-per-view once a month, and letting their guys go out and make money elsewhere, guys are able to dictate their schedules with healthcare benefits.
Yep.
and still be on television and still be prominently used and still have merchandise royalty rights. I mean, that's kind of as good as it gets. You know what I mean? Like, of course, guys want to be out there and getting seen. But at the same token, it's like, you know, if a guy wants to take a month off and just work television so he can recoup his body, by all means, they're able to do it. It's not like, okay, well, we've got a 4-day stretch here and then an overseas tour. And then you come back and you do a 3-day stretch and then you got 2 days off. And then we're going on, you know, we have to go to the Middle East and you're going to get stuck there again because of Saudi blood money. And then, you know, we're going to fly you to Buffalo like that night because, you know, that's the way the show runs.
Yeah, absolutely. And the thing is with AEW allowing their talent to work on their shows and everything, prime example of this, Wednesday night, Butcher and the Blade had a tag team match against QT Marshall and Cody Rhodes. Amazing match. On Friday night, both the Blade, known as Pepper Parks to a lot, a.k.a. Braxton Sutter from Impact, and Andy Williams, who is the Butcher, who's the, I believe, bassist in Every Time I Die, literally was back in Buffalo, New York for a 2-night concert event, Tis the Season or whatever, where Andy Williams played 2 back-to-back nights in Every Time I Die and also wrestled a match along with the Blade versus the Best Friends.
Yeah, I mean, this is the opportunities that you're able to get. You're able to see these television stars on your local independent scene that are still, I mean, you know, NEW champion is Darby Allin, and he's over in Israel with the championship. You know, I mean, that's monumental that belt is getting represented by a guy in Israel who is also a nationally recognized star who had a breakout match with Chris Jericho earlier this year.
Also, I believe Sammy Guerra worked a show over the weekend. He shared footage of it to Twitter. I can't remember where the show was. I believe it was overseas too. Or something like that. He shared it on Twitter, and it's like these guys are being seen on television in the States and everything, but then you're getting them to see them on a local sense on the weekends.
It reminds me of the traveling NWA champion. You know what I mean? Like,
oh yeah,
these guys, you're seeing them on TNT, and then they're able to go out and make a living elsewhere, but they also can kind of call their own shots with it, whether they want to accept the bookings and, you know, how far they want to travel, which is great when it comes to preserving the body, because everyone has a bump count. You know what I mean? Like, wrestlers or former wrestlers who are listening to this know that your body has a certain amount of bumps that it can take before it finally says, no, I can't do this anymore.
Oh, absolutely. And on top of that, to make a sports analogy, they interviewed LeBron James after the game last night, I believe. And they were talking about, is there a possibility of seeing LeBron James and his son in the NBA at the same time? And LeBron James came out, like, first thing he said, he's like, with how my body feels right now, no.
Yeah. I mean, that's exactly the thing. I mean, this is LeBron James, who is constantly ever working on his physical game. I mean, he's a goddamn specimen, you know what I mean? But, I mean, it all takes its toll on you. I mean, very rarely do we get father and son combinations in the ring together in professional wrestling. I mean, we will probably see it at least with Rey Mysterio and Dominic. There's a high probability of that.
Yeah.
You know, but, I mean, Chavo Guerrero and Chavo Sr., okay? But it wasn't like Chavo Sr. was the greatest of specimens at the time. His body had been beaten up, you know, quite a bit. The Colognes, maybe in Puerto Rico. The only other one that I think could probably come to my mind is, like, Greg and Vern.
Yeah.
And maybe the Von Erichs, but even then, like, they all acknowledged, like, Dad wasn't exactly in top form then. I mean, you don't get your dad even close to his prime, and you even near coming scratching the surface of how good you're going to be in the same ring at the same time. It just doesn't happen.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, and that's the thing. But at this point, we're going to take a small break and then come back, finish up the last segment of the show. Thank you for listening to CTRP. We'll be right back. Ladies and gentlemen, it is Pat G from the Turnbuckle Talk Radio podcast. And no, we're not talking pro wrestling today, but we are talking sports hoodies, NFL, NBA, MLB, NHL, soccer, and much more. And this is brought to you by houseofhoodies.com, a new sponsor here at the TTRP. You can visit thehouseofhoodies.com and pick up your favorite team's merchandise. They have current players, former players, or you can customize your own hoodie, whether it be the NBA, NHL, MLB, and the NFL. After you're done shopping, use the promo code TTRPodcast and you will get 15% off your order. That's TTRPodcast for 15% off at thehouseofhoodies.com. TTRP, hopefully if I decide to put that intro in, it won't get shacked for copyright infringement, but we'll see. Anyways, Patchy, Dan Fury, and the last segment of the night is going to be Corey Graves and his, so to speak, hot takes in the professional wrestling world that kind of finally got somebody to acknowledge it a little bit. Of course, Corey Graves being the quote unquote future voice of WWE television, in my opinion, I believe they're grooming him to eventually replace Michael Cole. But, WWE has given him a podcast. He's has quite a following on social media, on Twitter mainly, of course. And some of the recent things he's tweeted about has caught him in the crosshairs of some people. His tweets about NXT TakeOver and Mauro Ranallo, among other things, and then recently tweeted out a picture of Vic Joseph and Samoa Joe, essentially calling them an improved Taz and Michael Cole, which Taz responded to and said, when Joseph and Joe kind of get put in all the time and miles that him and Cole did and earn their due and pay their dues, then come talk to him, essentially. But
yeah,
it's this thing of he understands Corey Graves. Corey Graves has the podcast given to him by WWE and he has this thing, but it sounds like Taz has basically said Corey Graves is out there trying to create controversy and give this hot takes and create something that honestly isn't there in today's wrestling world.
He's being an asshole. Okay, let's be 100% blunt. He is what Mean Gene Okerlund would have been if Mean Gene had a Twitter. Okay, I am going to take some crap for that. I'm comparing him to Mean Gene Okerlund or him to Bobby the Brain Heenan on commentary, not managing, on commentary, is quite a stretch. But follow me here. Corey Graves makes these broad paintbrush statements and he gets under your skin. He's trolling. He's trolling all of these wrestling fans because he knows if he says something like that, it'll get people hot and bothered. His comments about, you know, Mauro Ranallo's commentating on the NXT War Games pay-per-view. First off, every single person that listened to that pay-per-view knows, you know, quite the opposite. You know, he can eat a dick if that was his honest opinion. He did recant and say, look, he's a friend. I'm sorry. I shouldn't have been so critical. You know, people say things in the heat of the moment. We've talked about this on this podcast before where, you know, you have 180 characters where you can shoot yourself in the foot real fast. And all it takes is someone, because there are these weird people out there that are constantly looking on Twitter and screenshotting like instantly if you post anything, blah, 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 blah. And Corey Graves being disliked for his beliefs and opinions on it. I think the picture of Samoa Joe with the new improved colon Taz, it's a bit tongue-in-cheek. Okay. You know, because once again, it's the submission wrestler doing, you know, color commentary with the scrawny dude who kind of looks like he should eat a cheeseburger and stop doing CrossFit. You know, I mean, it is what it is. I think he's masterfully playing professional wrestling fans because he knows that it doesn't take much to get them all hot and bothered.
Baron Corbin proved that instantly within about 3 seconds of WWE backstage this past week. Okay. Cause Baron Corbin was on, or last week. Yeah. Last week, Baron Corbin came out and they were doing the interview and he's like, I love wrestling Twitter. And CM Punk even said it. And instantly it was like, yeah, I love that. And the backstage, guy, Ryan Satin, who runs Pro Wrestling Sheets, I believe also, he tweeted out that exact statement or whatever what Corbin said, and literally 2 minutes after, somebody had like essentially said something, and it was like, he's like, my point is proven.
I mean, wrestling fans get so angry, but that's the passion of being a wrestling fan. You know, we're passionate about our sport. You know, I mean, you are currently located in Buffalo, and I can tell you right now, when I mention passion, you have some of the most passionate football fans out there, because one of my favorite things to see on social media is a dude marching around in his backyard getting six packs of beer thrown at him every single time the Bills win, and the Bills went to the playoff, are going to the playoffs, he busts open a bottle of the bubbly and 2 6 packs with his friends waving flags in a snowstorm, smashing them in the air like Stone Cold Steve Austin. And it's like, yeah, would you really talk smack about the Buffalo Bills in front of that guy?
Not to mention the 2,000 fans that were out at the airport this morning at 2 a.m. in 25 degree weather when the Bills returned from Pittsburgh.
Exactly. It's like, dude, people love their sports, and when you're passionate about it, you're willing to be more vocal. Do I think that maybe Corey Graves hits the nerve on that one? Absolutely. Does Corey Graves knows he hits the nerve on that one? Absolutely. Do you think he gives a rat's ass? Absolutely not.
Not at all. And this is the thing. You got to remember, you got to look at the times that we live in. And because it is 2019, you have Instagram, you have Twitter, you have Facebook, you have Snapchat, you have all these social media platforms. Granted, yes, probably the forefathers of professional wrestling that lived and breathed kayfabe, good guys stay away from bad guys, and all this other stuff. And if you get caught, you're in trouble, and all this stuff. Probably are rolling in their graves, but that's the quote unquote advancement of the times and everything. Imagine your typical heel. Your top heel from, say, the 1980s, imagine a Iron Sheik or Nikolai Volkov, like, legitimately in their heel things, having a Twitter.
We've joked around on this show, the magic is gone. Undertaker has an Instagram.
Yes.
But at the same token, back then when the kayfabe was way more stringent, oh my God, I would shudder to think of the pictures that would have been posted. First off, like, could you imagine Iron Sheik being like, Iron Sheik, Bobby, gonna wake up right now, he's going to drink the Jack Daniels, he's gonna have the crown, right, you pussy. But that was the worst Iron Sheik impersonation ever. But you get my drift.
Yep.
You know, would I want to see Iron Sheik on Instagram? Fuck no. But would it have been kind of funny? Fuck yeah. But the other part about Corey Graves on, you know, on trolling is he's not afraid to make a statement
that no.
fans can agree on and get behind. Like, case in point, it's coming up on Hall of Fame time. He recently made the statement that the Great Muta needs to be in the WWE Hall of Fame.
Yes, he did. And I completely agree with you.
And I think every single wrestling fan probably sat there for 5 seconds and was like, well, Antonio Inoki is in. Okay. The Great Muta. And they're all looking around. I guarantee they're all looking around like, how did this get past us? You know what I mean? Like, Corey Graves brings up a very valid point. Someone like the Great Muta should be in there. I mean, you have to take what he's saying in some instances with a grain of salt, but then with other instances, he's speaking from the heart of a wrestling fan, where I think every single wrestling fan can say unequivocally guys like Great Muta or Jushin Thunder Liger should be in the Hall of Fame, and you're like, damn, I hate to agree with him, but he's right.
Yeah. Absolutely. And the thing is you got to remember, Corey Graves has been doing commentary now for WWE for 5 years.
Uh-huh.
Because he just recently had the 5-year anniversary of him announcing his in-ring retirement from concussions. And he's been doing commentary for 5 years now, starting with NXT and moving up through the ranks and paying his dues to get where he's at.
Yeah, and, you know, he's one of these guys where, you know, he knows his role. He's evolving with his character. He's trying to be kind of the voice of the fans and the voice of the boys at the same time. And, you know, for me, do I see him, like you said, taking over as kind of like the voice of WWE? Yeah, I think with more time, he will end up being the lead commentator, and he will be the lead guy. And he will continue to do what he's been doing on social media, and he'll continue to push everyone's buttons. Because, you know, you have other commentators going out there and making statements which some would consider kind of barbing or rude. You know, case in point, JR's tweet a while back in rebut to Seth Rollins, where he's like, when you're as over as your girlfriend, give us a call. You know, in regards to his, you know, he being Seth Rollins, verbal attack of Kenny Omega being in the minor leagues. You know, it's like you got other commentators that go out there and say stuff like that, and you've got fans being like, oh shit, JR just dropped the bomb. But then you've got like Corey Graves going out there and just making a joke about Taz and Michael Cole, a la Samoa Joe. And then all of a sudden it's like, oh, you can't do that. That's mean. It's like, you shut up. Just shut up. Let the dude do his job, and his job is getting under your skin so that you have eyes on the product. He sells himself as a character very well.
Yeah, absolutely. He does. And this is the thing today in pro wrestling and everything, it's all about your character work, and it's all about the character work. And unfortunately, with the character work, it's no longer really a character, so to speak. It's just yourself turned up. That's all it is. That's all it is.
And Corey Graves goes out there, and he is his character. He is Corey Graves. You know, he is the guy who now has the official WWE podcast, because, you know, I'm sure they want to wrangle any news and any perspectives, and he wants to go out there. But also, you know, like when the network first started, Corey Graves had his Culture Shock shows that were on there.
Yep.
You know, he's had episodes of other shows that have kind of been dedicated to him. It's like they've kind of primed us for, like, this is how this guy is. You know, he's kind of punk rock. He's, you know, he's indie music kind of vibe. It's like, okay, cool. You know, it's like he's also a passionate wrestling fan. And the fact that he talks about it so openly and honestly, you know, give the guy the credit that he deserves. I mean, he is putting in the time and busting his ass in order to give us the best product possible.
Absolutely. To finish up here, Corey Graves, I like Corey Graves, but then I don't like Corey Graves. It's kind of like one of the things of Corey Graves can easily push your buttons, but he can make you agree with him as well. And that's the great thing about Corey Graves. Corey Graves essentially is one of them commentators that in 15, 20 years, we're going to be like, hey, okay, how good was this guy? Essentially, like Corey Graves is, and you brought up Mean Gene and Bobby Heenan. Corey Graves, to me, in 20 years, is going to be this generation's Bobby Heenan, essentially. With what Bobby Heenan was for, like, me and you and others, that's what Corey Graves is going to be to the kids that are listening to him now.
Because, you know, and to kind of put a stamp on this one from my perspective, my favorite Bobby the Brain Heenan moments were him on commentary just being a jerk, but also being a jerk to not just the good guys that were in the ring, also the bad guys. He wasn't afraid to talk smack about any side as long as it made him, you know, and Gorilla Monsoon get a moment. And yep. I mean, come on. As kids, to hear Gorilla Monsoon look up to Bobby the Brain Heenan and go, "Will you stop? Come on." That meant that Brain was doing his job.
Exactly. And same thing with Michael Cole, with how Michael Cole reacts to Corey Graves.
Exactly.
But something fun to finish off the show with real quick is, have you seen the videos from Xavier Woods?
I have not. I know that he's out, obviously, with injury.
Yes.
But I have not kept up on him on social media. What am I missing out on?
He has this ridiculous but amazing Pokemon theory.
Oh, dear Lord.
And essentially, like, he made the assumption of Pokemon kind of, and he's like, when I was a kid and whatever, now that I've seen this as an adult, he's like, you're basically an 8 to 10 year old, and you're like given a Pokemon and sent out into the world to survive on your own.
I actually thought about that, yeah.
And he's essentially made it to seem like Pokemon is the quote unquote, like, Battle Royale / Hunger Games type deal, where it's and whatnot, and there's these kids that never made it to the gym and stuff that are kind of like that have been killed, like essentially dead or killed by Pokemon or whatever, and how he's thought about who if a war actually happened, who would win, the Pokemon or humans. And like the video is just, it's like, it's some dark shit, but it's
so,
like,
is he going ancient aliens on us?
I don't know exactly, but it's one of them things of, it was one of the things of just, it made you think. It really made you think. I don't know. I'll have to send you the video of him doing it, but
please do.
It was essentially like, oh, I, you know what? I just found the video. So I'm going to do something we haven't done before. I'm going to play it. That way you can hear it as well.
My first episode of Pokemon. And as an adult who's had more life experiences than childhood me, there's a bunch of things that are kicking out of my mind right now. A bunch of them I talked to some of you on Twitter about. I've got a poll right now going on. If there was a full-fledged war between human and Pokemon, who would win? I say Pokemon. They can control space and time. Anyway, I digress. So when a kid is 10, they get a Pokeball and they go out to the world on this dangerous mission with no adult supervision. When you play the game, you encounter some people who have Pokemon that you fight against. Some of them are kindergartners. So 10 and under are given Pokemon and go on this mission with no adult supervision. When I was was 10, it was hard enough for me to wipe my own cheeks, much less fight animals with an animal sidekick. I don't understand this. How many of those kids actually make it to the first gym and get their first badge? And how many of those kids are just rotting away in tall grass because Pokemon did them in? We don't talk about that. We don't even think about that. Yes, it's very dark. I understand that. But logistically speaking, is Pokemon essentially their universe's way of having Battle Royale, or for the Americans in the room, Hunger Games? Is that the point? To quell the population because there's too many people? Battle Royale, they get a whole school full of children, a whole class, whatever it is, and then they can do battle against each other till one's left. In this world, they give you Pokemon and say, hey, you're 8, you're 10, you can survive out in the wilderness on your own. No, you can't. No, you cannot. So they deal with the population that way? Am I messed up? Thoughts, please.
But yes. So he's essentially talked about how Pokemon is essentially the population control, aka Battle Royale, the Japanese movie, and then Hunger Games, which Battle Royale essentially inspired.
Xavier Woods, please come back to the ring. You desperately need to wrestle, and I hope all the best for you and your mental instability during these dark, dark times. However, I would like to agree with him that due to the fact that Pokemon control space and time, they would overthrow us and kill us. Mewtwo is telekinetic, and I ain't messing with that.
I know, right? I'm like... When he said that, I was like, "That you're not wrong." I was like, "You're not wrong."
Yeah, I'm just gonna say it. Mewtwo telekinetic.
Mewtwo telekinetic, and that's how we're gonna end Turnbuckle Talk. Thank you for listening to this edition of the Turnbuckle Talk Radio, episode 84. Yes, we ended a wrestling podcast with Pokemon.
Pokemon.
For Dan Fury, Pat G, this has been the TTRP. Thank you for listening. We will see you on the flip side. The Turnbuckle Talk Radio podcast is brought to you by Gear Network and ShopGear.com. We can be listened to via Spotify, iTunes, iHeartRadio, and everywhere else you can get your podcasts. The TTRP introduction was done by Trevor Dugan. The show is hosted by Patrick Angeski and Daniel Roberts. Post-production of the TTRP is done by Patrick Angeski and John Cimino. If you'd like to follow us via social media, you can search Turnbuckle Talk Radio Podcast on Facebook. You can follow us at Twitter by using the name Turnbuckle_talk. Or if you have questions or concerns, you can reach us via email at turnbuckletlkradio@gmail.com. We'd like to thank you for listening to the Turnbuckle Talk Radio Podcast, downloading our episodes, following us on social media, and interacting with us.
The preceding presentation has been brought to you by the Gear Network.